Welcome back to Jedi Jive, everybody. My name is Mike, and joining us again is my sister Jenny.
Hey, guys.
We're going to do another What If reaction. Last week, we really enjoyed the episode.
Star-Lord, T'Challa in space. Black Panther in space.
Yeah, and it was Chadwick Boseman's, technically, his last episode. We know that we're going to see maybe his
officially
T'Challa
there
appear
are
again, but
three cameo appearances in three subsequent episodes coming, but that was his big...
So yeah, that was bittersweet, but it was very enjoyable, and it was a very uplifting episode, honestly. There was just a lot of positivity, and it was just feel-good.
I thought so, too. I mean, in more ways than one. There were so many things that were just optimistic at the end of it, which, Lord knows, we could all use a little bit of right now. So, you know, whether it was the fact that, like, his real family and his adopted family got along, the little slave girl getting to be in charge for once, the sort of greenification, the eco-greening of nowhere was really cool. There was a lot of, like, happiness at the end of last week's episode.
Yeah. And, well, anyway, moving forward to this week, it says that it's going to be, what if if Nick Fury was having trouble assembling the Avengers because they were all getting picked off by a serial killer?
Yeah, it's very interesting.
This
sort of
crazy scenario.
Villain who targets superheroes is not a particularly new idea,
no.
But it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out in this fantasy multiverse world of the Avengers, of the MCU.
Yeah, is it going to be like a Zemo type character, except like they're like succeeding?
We'll find out.
Or, you know, who's going to want to kill superheroes?
Yeah.
I guess we'll see. But anyway, it's been interesting. Some of our discussion has centered around the art style and that being enjoyable. Also, the fact that right now Marvel is sort of in the midst of like a, you know, it's branching out this whole, literally and metaphorically, because you know, we started this year with WandaVision. It was like, Marvel's back, all right. And Falcon and the Winter Soldier, we were tackling some new issues for Marvel, like, you know, racism and things like that. But, you know, really, like, we're still sort of, like, solidly in the Marvel universe. But then Loki comes along, and the multiverse is a thing now. And I think the doors have just been blown wide open. But now with What If, all of a sudden in Marvel, it seems like anything's possible.
Yeah,
anything and everything can and will happen.
This entire series, in a way, is sort of a teaser trailer for what is possible.
Yeah.
Moving forward. Obviously, these are kind of wild flights of fancy. Like, I don't actually think that Black Panther 2 is going to be Black Panther in space. However, I think the idea that, like, really anything is possible is sort of a foundation for what the MCU is going to be like from here on out.
Yeah. Well, right now,
things are going to get wild.
The Spider-Man No Way Home trailer is kind of like the hot thing of the moment right now. And meanwhile, people might have forgotten, hey, what if is still going on here?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I'm excited for us to get into another episode.
Yeah, let's have a look.
Let's do it.
Samuel L. Jackson.
Jeremy Renner.
We got some Hawkeye. Some Hulk.
Tom Hiddleston.
Loki's showing up.
Right.
Agent Phil Coulson. Lady Sif.
All right,
we got what's his face who died in Lake Bell, amazing actress.
Is Frank Grillo the Hydra guy?
Yeah, what's the name of that character? Crossbones.
Okay, yeah. I really feel like if Stan Lee was still alive, he'd be doing the voice of the Watcher.
100%.
He'd be narrating.
100%. But I do love Jeffrey Wright. He is one of the loveliest actors in America. Monday.
Da-da-da.
I know, it's already like a cop show.
Avengers Initiative on that.
That's a real donut shop. That's a very famous donut shop in LA. Kind of down near the airport.
Yep. The center of my universe.
I get it.
Hit him.
It's not a cure. It just abates the symptoms.
Ooh.
Tony. He's dead.
What?
You guys are no fun. Here, mind holding these for me?
Of course, What?
Nice. Good animation.
Stop the truck! No. Oh, come on!
Oh, where's she supposed to have gone while they were driving?
She can shimmy up a truck in motion. Come on, it's Black Widow.
And
she's
then,
done
like,
worse.
Magnetic, neutron, vital radiations, all off the charts.
This is very reminiscent of the actual movie.
Mm-hmm.
a Caucasian male, mid-20s, with really great hair.
It's an accurate description.
Sorry. It's
an accurate description. He's gorgeous.
Whoa, Coulson wasn't lying about the hair.
Hold your...
Okay.
I told you to stand down.
I did. Wasn't me. I didn't shoot.
Wake up, Sleeping Beauty. Bart.
How could this... Who did you
let
in here?
Dropping like flies. It's gotta be Loki, right? He's a shapeshifter. He can perform illusions.
There was no sign of struggle, no entry wounds.
It's weird. But I also have a space corpse that looks like a Chippendales dancer riding on the moon.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
He smells good.
He smells like lavender.
Oh my god.
Dr. Ross, not sure if you remember me, but...
Oh, I remember.
It's like Liv Tyler from The Hulk, right?
I'm here about Tony Stark. I believe he was murdered. Or at least someone's trying to make it look that way. Using this. Huh.
Stan Lee's Pizza Parlor.
I got bad news and worse news. Barton's dead. I know what he
it's
meant
her bestie.
To you.
Who do I kill? Who else is on the list?
That's the thing. Bruce Banner. And you. But first, find Banner.
Funny thing, boss. Think I already have.
No need for violence, Agent Romanoff. That's probably not gonna work out.
What? What is it?
We need to go.
Ominous, the way the Watcher is just
He's
there.
He's just lurking.
Motionless.
Coffee run. Needed a breather. Got you a double macchiato. Just now you like it.
Oh my goodness.
What are you seeing, Coulson?
A meteor
phenomenon
of some kind. Whatever it is, it came with bogeys.
They look like they're from Earth?
Maybe Middle Earth?
No, it's an Asgard. Yeah. Maybe Middle Earth. It's an Asgardian horde.
Looking for directions, sir? Because you seem to have lost your way.
You would do best to kneel before a god.
I am Loki, Crown Prince of Asgard, the rightful king of Jotun. And god of mischief. Are you gonna take that? I'm in the middle of something here.
Damn it, Fury. Pick up. Got General Ross, a dozen snipers, and a few tanks. What are you dealing with?
Space Vikings.
Show off.
Handle it and get to ground.
Well, what exactly is it that brought you here, Mr. Loki?
Vengeance. An agent of this planet murdered Thor Odinson, the Crown Prince of Asgard.
So he's not the one killing everybody.
Sir, we're clear.
Bruce, it's okay. We're okay, right? I'll get you out of this. I swear on my life.
Agent Romanoff, I think you might be better off getting out of here.
Here comes the big guy.
What's in the box?
What's in the box? What's in the box?
Oh my god.
Hulk smash. What?
What's happening? He's...
Oh my god, he's gonna... He's gonna explode.
Gonna explode?
Holy
Yikes.
Shit. Wouldn't there be like green ooze everywhere?
Yeah, they'd get slimed like Nickelodeon in the 90s.
Declaring war on this planet will not bring your prince back!
Wait. He's not wrong.
The person who killed your brother also killed two of my people. Good people. We should be working together. I promise. When I find your brother's killer, you will have your pound of flesh.
What a fascinating choice of words.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you my password, Romanoff.
Why not?
Because I'm not.
Coulson. Clint was your friend too.
Hashtag Steve, I heart Steve, 0704.
Huh. How did a woman who died 2 years ago access the database yesterday? You won't win.
Who is this invisible assassin?
Who did she just call? It looked like it said dad.
You found me. You know what
it said calling mobile.
So it's
deliberately not. We're not sure who she's calling. She said a woman who died 2 years ago.
No, I think I just heard Fury's voice.
Oh. Yeah, so it's Fury. Could it be some quantum realm stuff? Janet Van Dyne's name was on that file she pulled up.
Yeah.
It's hope. It's all about hope.
Hope Van Dyne. If it's like an Ant-Man, that would explain how someone got into a cell.
Sure. Yeah. Was that the Captain Marvel device?
Is that a beeper from the 90s?
Who's this? Is that robot that tries to kill Thor?
Right.
I was just guarding.
Maybe. Yeah, that's the Golden Gate Bridge, San Francisco, Ant-Man, the Van Dynes. All right, so Hope died 2 years ago.
If it isn't Hank Pym.
The balls you have to come here. She died because S.H.I.E.L.D. killed her. She died because of you.
Oh.
You filled her head.
He sounds like Michael Douglas.
About protecting humanity.
It's Hank Pym as the Yellow Jacket.
Hank Pym as the Yellow Jacket.
And you're right. Yeah, it's miniaturization. Yeah. That's how he got in the cell. And
that made sense. As long as it wasn't like Asgardian magic, there had to be an explanation for like getting into small places undetected.
Sold him some malarkey about being a hero.
Malarkey.
That's what you do.
That's it? You murdered him because you could?
His death was a favor. Yours will be a triumph.
Oh, it just smacks him. Hello, Big Fury.
Nice. Effect.
What the? You're still pretty spry for a guy with a corner office.
Yeah, the Yellow Jacket outfit. Giving him the smackdown.
Kill me!
How are you,
Wait.
Stop moving, Fury! What are you doing?
What kind of skills does Nick Fury have in this universe? Or is Loki helping from behind the scenes? Illusion.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
He's making an illusion and ice. It's probably actually Loki, not Nick Fury at all. Yeah.
There you go.
What's with the goth kid?
Hello.
And I would have got away with it if it weren't for you damn kid.
Yeah.
Now take your hammer and get off my planet.
About that, we should be allies. I was thinking I might extend my stay here on Midgard.
For how long?
The Asgardian delegation has arrived at the UN.
In just one day's time, the nations of Earth have put aside their differences and united under my command.
Oh, no.
I doubt that.
Joy. You were made to be
ruled. Big invasion.
So I have come to help you fulfill your destiny.
There's nobody to stop him either. They're all dead.
A big Independence Day style alien invasion.
The Avengers were always meant to be more than a team. They were an idea.
They've all got their little coat of arms.
Mm-hmm.
Their little sigils.
Welcome back, Captain.
Yeah. So, hashtag Steve, I love you, Steve. 411 or whatever it was.
Captain Marvel came.
Yeah.
So Captain America and Captain Marvel are
the captains will take care of things.
Wow.
So they killed off like all of the phase one.
Yeah, you were right.
Heroes was, except for Steve.
You
basically.
Were like, is it going to be a quantum Ant-Man type thing? And it was. It was.
Yeah,
it was
not
Hank
quantum
Pym.
Realm, but it was Hank Pym. Miniaturizing himself in the Yellow Jacket costume, which Corey Stoll wore in the film, in the first Ant-Man film. Because the Wasp is Hope's outfit when she becomes Wasp. In this universe, Hope was an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yep, and she got
killed.
And
had been killed in the line of duty or on a mission.
So he was just on like a revenge or a...
Like a revenge-fueled, you know, mania, kind of. His wife had previously died, as in the Ant-Man films.
Yeah.
And then his daughter died, and... We don't know what all happened to him in the meantime, but went a little nuts.
Yeah. The crazy thing here is that, like, all of these characters, all of these Avengers are characters were used to being, like, just, like, almost unkillable. That, like, literally Hulk, where it's literally like, right. I can't be killed. And then, like, seeing every single one of them die so unceremoniously.
Like,
Hulk explodes.
Tony
Thor gets
Stark,
shot,
like, the founder of the entire MCU. Like, first
kills over dead.
Moments of the episode, just dead, dead, dead.
I mean, Natasha did get to, like, looks like she defended herself for a second, but basically none of them got to fight back. It was all just dead, 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 dead.
And I mean, it's funny because we initially had thought, oh, maybe it's Loki doing all of this, getting rid of his opponents so that he can take over Earth, which did end up kind of happening. He did take over Earth, but that was actually kind of classic Loki, which is that he took advantage of circumstance. He like assessed his surroundings and worked the situation to his advantage.
Yeah, this is what Loki wanted from Battle of New York, but didn't get.
Didn't get, exactly, because the Avengers were there to stand in his way.
Didn't even need to have Battle of New York here.
No.
And then presumably in this universe, like we said, Captain Marvel and Captain America are the ones that are there to defend.
Save the day.
So whether or not we'll see the continuation of that storyline, I don't know. But that's another kind of subject we were talking about with What If so far, is that like each episode ends with like, oh, well, what happens next? So... they're these little self-contained what-if scenarios, but they do have all of them so
they
far
all have
potential
like ended
for,
with an open and open-ended
story.
Let's
see Ego and Peter Quill. What happens with them? What happens with Captain Carter? What happens
with Steven and Carol teaming up?
Yeah,
loved to see Phil Coulson again.
You're such a huge Coulson fan.
I am a giant Coulson fan. I'm a giant Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fan. But I think even amongst people who aren't huge Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. fans, Coulson is like one of the most significant crossover characters who does appear in both the show. He's the star of his own show, but he was a significant character in the films as well. And so it's always nice. And I think he's sort of universally a beloved character. It's hard not to like Phil Coulson, the way Clark Gregg plays him. So it's great to see him again. I loved how they were constantly sort of making fun of him for being a giant dork. Which, again, is, like, right in character. His whole, like, big crush on Steve thing is funny because the character Coulson is obsessed with, like, history and World War II era. And that's true. In Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., he has a whole little sort of gallery collection where he's collected all sorts of old, SSR and, like, Avengers memorabilia from the 40s and stuff. So that actually was, like, right on brand for him. And just constantly sort of joking, and the dynamic between Coulson and Fury where like shit's going down and they're just kind of like, hey, what are you up to? Cool, I'll take care of this guy.
He's like, I got
that.
You a double mocha, whatever.
Double macchiato, just how you like it.
For a minute there, we were like, we thought that it was like, whoa, we'd never seen Nick Fury. I didn't know he could throw down like this.
Right,
like,
and then a moment later, it was like, oh, illusions. Loki, obviously. Like, this is a trick we've seen him do before with like the many versions of himself or whatever.
Yeah.
But it was good. That was like a classic, a classic switcheroo at the end to be like, oh, haha, they were working together this entire time.
Loki did end up like taking over at the end, like as he would. But at the same time, like we were kind of assuming where it was like, oh, it's always nefarious with Loki. He's showing up to take over. But it really was him showing up
to avenge his brother.
To defend his brother. Like,
yeah, that's why I say, I don't know if, like, always nefarious is quite the right nuance of the way Loki is. It's that he is always on his toes.
He showed up to defend Thor, but then
he's always willing to take advantage of a situation. He's always looking for his angle in every situation. That's what I say is, like, classic Loki. Like, that's in character. That makes sense for that character.
Classic Loki, literally, even this is the
even the costume was, like, very classic Loki with the big long horns and everything. So
very much so.
Everything about that was kind of classic Loki in every sense.
Yeah.
I enjoy the humor that has consistently come into these. Like, we talked a lot last week.
A little bit different in each episode in terms, like, in this episode, I feel like you said, it was, like, the, like, talking about the coffee and, like, sort of the date. Like, when it was, like, Monday, Tuesday.
Yeah, they made it, like, a cop show. You did expect to hear that Law and Order kind of dun-dun, like, But that was very much like what you would see on a sort of CSI type show where they're trying to solve the case and some new crazy thing keeps happening every time they get close.
Yeah.
So it was funny how they sort of, even within, they're already within a specialized format in that this is an animated show, mm-hmm. but even within the bounds of the animated show, they found a way to play with genre and to sort of poke fun at a television procedural cop show sort of genre, which yeah. was cute. I've enjoyed the humor and the sort of self-awareness, the sort of, not fourth wall breaking, but the sort of self-conscious meta humor that has been deployed throughout all three episodes yeah. we've seen so far. They're yeah. not afraid to take cheap shots at themselves, and it's enjoyable.
One more subject that we've sort of touched on in regards to What If is the sort of canon aspect of all of it, in that, like, this is canon because they said it's
a
canon,
multiverse,
but
right,
yeah, this
right.
is a multiversal.
Like, in theory, literally any weird possibility you can think of exists in some yeah. random, far-off branch of the multiverse, you know?
So, for, you know, for, like, conversation's sake, it's like, yes, okay, this is canon, but it's also these unique what-if scenarios. But at yeah. the same time, we're now, like I said, like, Spider-Man No Way Home trailer just dropped, Loki just finished, where, like, Sylvie essentially helped create the multiverse.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, at some point, you're wondering, well, if this really is canon, like, how is this going to be relevant to, like, because it's funny, because in this universe, there was a sacred timeline, and now right. there's multiple timelines. But for us as the Watchers, like, we have our own sacred timeline,
right.
our own, like, main storyline.
I think that's
exactly
why I think, as a lot of you know, if you've watched our channel for a while, I tend to hate having conversations about what's canon.
Yeah.
You know, to each his own, but I tend to find these conversations very asinine, because I feel like that's only one aspect of what's going on. Like, we could argue for days about what detail happened in something 8 years ago that makes it canon, but I think, frankly, the more important consideration is, what do the majority of your viewers attach to? We call it headcanon, but, you know, like, what are people attached to? What are people going to retain and mm-hmm. cling to and, like, want to see more of or be upset about? That it's storytelling stuff. Yeah. It's basic storytelling stuff. And so I think the thing about this that I've said before, I think by putting it in the animated format, they kind of cover both bases. They can yeah. be like, for all of you people who are obsessed with figuring out what someone said 8 years ago, yes, it's canon.
Yeah.
But also, we're just kind of like going off and doing a separate thing. And this isn't very, like, you could definitely keep watching all the live action aspects of the MCU without seeing this and not feel like you're missing.
Yes.
Information.
Yeah.
Exposition, a plot point, you know. This is just sort of for fun. What if? Like, let's just throw all the shit at the wall and do all of it.
Yeah.
But in, like, a fun, animated, televised format.
Yeah.
And
one other thing that I think is worth mentioning is that we were talking about how, like, the Watcher is essentially, like, a stand-in for Stan Lee and
yeah.
the narrative voice that he has over the Marvel Universe. And that, like, possibly if Stan Lee was still around, like,
he might even be voicing
the Watcher.
Yeah.
But there was the Pete the Hat in the lab that said, like, Stan Lee's pizzeria
or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, like, thinking about all the ways we used to get, like, little Stan Lee cameos.
Yeah.
And that, like, obviously we can't get that anymore.
But
and
they're still
here,
finding ways to bring him in, or at least to pay homage.
That was a nice fun way to be like, hey,
I think
hi,
that
Stan
is
Lee,
something
you know?
We can all share, is that every time we see, like, an homage to Stan Lee, we all kind of go like, oh, like, yeah, we
and then
get
there was that
feels.
One frame that showed the Watcher literally just standing there in the mist,
always,
like,
creeping. He
just
was
always watching.
He's always watching.
He's the Watcher.
Yeah, that's what he does.
But yeah, that
I still think that we may find out more about that entity's role in the MCU.
I don't think it's going to be anything significant beyond just, like, it's the narrative voice. It's a stand-in
of this
for
show.
Stanley.
I mean, that's
it's
entirely
not,
possible, but, you know,
it's not going to do anything other than watch and
it
talk.
It is sort of like, In the midst of what has been generally a very lighthearted, humorous show, it is this sort of ominous presence that remains mostly unexplained.
Sure.
And it's a world where we know we have gods and aliens and mutations of every description and superheroes
sure.
and, like, magic.
Yeah.
You know, it's a universe where all of these things are possible, so it's tempting to want to ascribe some kind of character or some kind of storyline to
yeah.
that. Well, I guess if they do anything with it, or if it's just like, this is the nice Stan Lee type character
yeah.
that we chose to include, we'll see.
It's so funny, you thinking know? About it, like, to like last week, there's this assembling an awesome voice cast with all these voice actors. Yeah. Everybody's happy. Everybody's alive. Nobody's killing each other in the end.
Yeah.
Just, and then here it's all the, another assembly of great actors, and then they're all just like getting
just killed right off.
Taken
I know.
Out one by
I mean,
one,
they like... didn't have Scarlett Johansson, but we got like a little bit of Mark Ruffalo. Mm-hmm. We got Jeremy Renner.
Yep.
We got
Tom Hiddleston, killed, yeah.
Clark Gregg, yeah. Samuel L. Jackson. It was like, again, a pretty heavy-hitting cast, yeah. And they all sort of came to work.
It's fun.
Yeah, I
all
like
right, guys. This is fun. Let us know what you thought about this in the comments below. If you want to see a fully unedited reaction, go to patreon.com/JediJive. I'll leave a link to the Discord below if you want to go join our Discord community. Don't forget to leave a thumbs up, hit that notification bell, subscribe. We'll see you in the next.
Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.